Sir, I formally welcome you in this series of webinar under the Institutional Development Project funded by the World Bank through ICAR. So I would like to introduce to the listeners, sir, mostly our BTech and MTech student and our faculty from Dairy Science College, sir. For the information of all, I would like to introduce formally Dr. D.C. Saxena, presently working as a professor in the Department of Food Engineering and Technology. And he is also Dean Students Welfare at Sant Longowal Institute of Engineering and Technology. He is a former Dean Planning and Development and former Head Department of Food Engineering and Technology. He is a visiting faculty at Asian Institute of Technology, Bangkok, and chairman of Mentor Council for Food Processing and Preservation Sector under Ministry of Labor and Employment, Government of India. He is a member of editorial board of Journal of Food Science and Technology for many years. And he is a member of various lecture committees of the various universities. He has visited abroad like countries like Hungary, Germany, Thailand, Switzerland, UK, Australia, Japan, China, Netherlands, Spain, UAE, US. So he's a widely traveled and highly, you can say, बहुत ज्यादा इनका जो एक्सपोजर है हाईली एक्सपोज्ड टू द फील्ड ऑफ दिस फूड इंजीनियरिंग ही इज आल्सो वन सो मेनी प्राइजेस एज एपी प्राइज इन 2014 बाय फूमा जापान देन फर्स्ट प्राइज फॉर इंटरनेशनल एट इंटरनेशनल कॉन्फ्रेंस थंजावर देन प्रोफेसर जीवन सिंह सिद्धू अवार्ड इन 2009 बाय एफएसएस Association of Food Scientists and Technologists India, and he is also a fellow of fellow 95 of IUFOST, that is 9th World Congress of Food Science Scientists and Technologists at Hungary. So Dr. Saxena has also undertaken various sponsored projects in the field of value addition to rice bran, development of product from sago and starch, and design and fabrication of gas-fired continuous tandoori roti making oven, design and fabrication of amla pricking machine for cottage scale industry, design and fabrication of amla grader, design and fabrication of infrared heating machine, and study of characterization and treatment of effluents from electroplating industries. So in the research field also, Dr. Saxena has contributed a lot. Okay. Then he is also a life member of various associations like AFST India, Oil Technologist Association of India, Indian Society of Technical Education, then Punjab Academy of Sciences. Then Dr. Saxena has published number of research papers, Web of Science, Scopus Indexed, and he's having a Google Scholar H index of 128. So I formally, once again, I formally welcome Dr. Saxena and invite him to deliver his today's talk. So, Dr. Saxena, kindly over to you, and please you can start your presentation.
Thank you, Dr. Amandeep. It's a very nice opportunity for me to join with you and other participants of this webinar. And I am really thankful to you and my dear student, Dr. Narendra. And whenever you invite me at your place, I used to come, and it's a really good opportunity for me to join you again. And I request all the participants to please mute your phone as well as to means to put off their video. And I'm also putting off my video because there is some networking problem. So just to save the bandwidth, I'll put off my video.
Right, sir.
Okay, so I'm sharing the screen. Okay, good morning, everybody. So the topic is very interesting. What is the need of study in rheology? In food processing, we come across so many problems because everywhere we cannot do heat and trial. Although we have adopted so many technology from our conventional knowledge. But to standardize those processes, we need some data. We need some standardization. Because it is not true that some person is very good in preparing or in the development terms of particular food or a food item. So another one also, he or she would be able to prepare the product with the same quality and same taste. Okay. And one more thing, we have to go for the commercialization of that technology. Cottage industries are good, but to cater those particular products at a larger scale, we need to have the commercialization of that technology. So there are so many things which we need for commercialization. Commercialization means use of machines. And whenever we go for using the machines, we need some parameters. And those parameters are not a result of 1 or 2 days. There is having ample study behind the production of those data and how to produce those data, how to get those parameters, particularly in the case of food products. There is a need of rheology. So I am going to deliver a lecture on this particular topic, means what is the importance of rheology in food processing. So as I have said a little bit, this particular science of rheology, it is having many applications in the field of food acceptability, food processing, food handling. How we can make the food acceptable to the society? We have to have different data. We have to have data regarding the intermediate product quality control or the final product quality control. And then we have to have the better shelf life. And to have that better shelf life, we need data again. There is a need of food rheology. Then food processing. For example, you want to send 1,000 liters of milk from one place to another or for processing further. So we need suitable pipelines. We need suitable pumps. We need pasteurizer, we need plate heat exchangers. So for that means which type of pipes we have to select, which type of pump we have to select. There the food rheology helps because that will give the parameters which are required for calculations in design of the equipment. The same thing happens in the food handling. How the ingredients are going to function in particular product development. Means what is the quality of those ingredients? how will they behave in the intermediate product preparation and the final product preparation, and how the machines are giving a good correlation with the sensory data. Because the food we consume, that gives us sensory, we use our sensory organs. But whether we can rely on those sensory organs to produce the product with the same quality, which can be acceptable to other person. So there we need the use of equipment, instruments, and to use that instrument, to use the standardization of those parameters, we have to use the rheology. Because food is a very complex material. They consist of so many mixture of solids as well as structural components. So it is complex material, either structurally and rheologically also. Because you take example of any, steel material. So that will not be a complex material, because we know the composition of steel, and that will be throughout the material, same throughout the material. But here in food, we cannot say that. So it is a very complex material. Structurally, if you take example of, apple. So at perimeter, at the center, it is different. And at the bottom and the top, it is different. Okay. Another example, say ice cream. It is having air, it is having fat. Okay, it is having liquid also. So it is very complex material. So what is rheology? Rheo means to flow. Logos means the science. And ology, the study. So the study of flow of materials. That should behave in an interesting or unusual manner. And these unusual materials, they are such as mayonnaise, peanut butter, chocolate, bread dough, and so many other things. So it is an interdisciplinary science. It involves physics, which can explain and predict different rheological properties. And it may consist molecular physics, statistical physics, and so many other branches of physics. Then it needs chemistry, which gives a direct correlation between chemical parameters and rheological parameters. And it can be determined by molecular mass, molecular weight determination, chemical structures, and other intermolecular interactions, which would help in the material design. And the mechanics of continuum theory, it is based on the continuum theory. So this study gave background for particular formulation of boundary problems, other in dynamics of liquids, which govern the equation and their solution. And that will give the numerical values of macro properties. Finally, it helps in developing the technology as well as engineering. For example, this is an analysis of flow problems and in new application, which further involve the rheological properties of that particular material. So it is a combination of physics, chemistry, mechanics of continuum, and then technology as well as engineering. So rheology is used to describe deformation and flow behavior of all kinds of material, because each material under load or under force, it is showing viscoelastic behavior. As a mixture of viscous and elastic behavior, so every food technologist should know this. So viscoelastic properties are in between the viscous and elastic. So here I have given the example, ideal viscous liquids such as water, oils, which follow the law of Newton. Then viscoelastic liquids, glues, shampoos, or paste. Then viscoelastic solids, these are paste gels, for example, rubbers also, some type of rubbers. And this is a concrete structure or iron structure. It may be ideally elastic. So Hooke's law govern this. And there are some oscillatory tests and their rotational tests. So I will discuss about this rheology road in my further slides. These are the rheological properties which should be known to each and every food technologist or food engineers, because these are the basic properties which are being used to develop the products, to study their behavior. So these are very common, I can say, is stress, which can be shear, normal and normal stress differences, then viscosity under steady state, and extensional or complex viscosity. And for the viscoelastic material, we have storage modulus, G prime, and loss modulus, G double prime. And based on these data, we study creep recovery, then compliance and decay study. And based on this data, we study the relaxation, stress relaxation. And there are so many other rheological properties which we are going to discuss in further slides. So rheology concerns about the flow and deformation of substances. Flow and deformation. So when we apply the force, either it will be a flow or means flow will be in the case of liquids, and deformation will be in the case of solids or semi-solids. And they're in particular concerned about their behavior in the transient area between solids and fluids. They suppose you can take example of dough. So earlier it is in the powder form. Then when we mix the water, it makes a dough. And whenever it is converted into bread, so again it is, you can say, solid. So from powder, liquid, semi-solid, then solid. So it attempts to define a relationship between the stress which acts on a given material and the resulting deformation and flow, as I have discussed earlier. So these are determined by particular measuring the force and deformation as a function of time. Time is very important. And further, we see that there may be some time-dependent and time-independent properties. So how the material responds to applied forces and further deformation, that would provide the nature of material. So these are the key to all rheological evaluation, particularly stress and strain. So stress is force per unit area. Same is the pressure, but that is different. It is always a measurement of force per unit of surface area, which is expressed in units of Pascal. And the direction of force is very important with respect to the impacted surface area, which determines the type of stress. So you take example of normal stress, when the force is directly perpendicular to the surface. So it can be tension or the compression. And the shear stress, when the forces are acting in the parallel direction to a surface. Here you can see, this is a cube. These are different stresses. These are the direction. So it is indicated as sigma suffix ig, so this subscript, where the first subscript, it is I, it refers to the orientation of the face upon which the force acts. And the second one, it refers to the direction of the force. So we'll see sigma 11, it is a normal stress. It is acting in the plane perpendicular to the S1 direction. In the direction of X1. And sigma 23, this one, it is a shear stress because it is a parallel to the surface and it is acting in the plane perpendicular to X2. This is X2. So perpendicular to X2, but parallel to X3. Okay? So parallel to X3, perpendicular to X2. So that is why it is having sigma 23. Now, the strain, it is a dimensionless quantity. because it is an always relative deformation. And direction of the applied stress with respect to the particular material surface, that will determine the type of strain. Normal strain and the compressive stress as well as tensile stress will be there when we pull apart. And when it is in the compression stage, that compressive stress. Okay, so that will behave like a normal strain. You can see that initial length was L naught, and upon acted by some force, there is a change in length at delta L. So based on this, the different equations are there: Hanke strain, Cauchy strain. Another, if you consider a rectangular bar of height h, not going into detail, so the angle of shear, it can be calculated by delta L, okay, upon h, this and this. And with a small deformation, the angle of shear, which is in the radians, that will be equal to the shear strain, but for the small deformation. So determine deforming forces that can be applied to gels during shear, compression, or tensile, then uniaxial force, then hydrostatic pressure that can change the volume, but not the shape of a specimen, whereas uniaxial tension or compression that can change both shape and volume. So these are some of the properties. So this Hooke's law, when the resulting stress versus a strain curve is a straight line, it is known to each and every food technologist, where G is the shear modulus, and these materials, they do not flow, and they are linearly elastic. And stress will remain constant until the strain is removed, and the material returns to its original shape. So this is the initial shape, and it is in the compression, under compression. So you have seen that its height has decreased, but the width has increased from RO, or you can say radius if it is cylindrical type. So from R naught to delta R is the change, and based upon that, it experiences a change in length and radius, and normal stress, F force per unit area, force per pi R square. And this is the strain, delta H, change in length or height, you can see, and change in height, initial height. Young's modulus is also known as modulus of elasticity. But if the deformations are large, then Hanke strain should be used instead of having Young modulus. So R naught initial radius and the change in radius. Okay. So it is a, you can say, deflected beam, flexural testing of beam. Here you can see the diameter, which is a cross-sectional area, circular cross-sectional area. And if we take rectangular cross-sectional area, so then equation will be different for this cantilever. These are three-point bending rig. Generally, we determined the properties of, you can say, crispiness of biscuit under this three-point bending rig. So different equations are there for rectangular cross-section as well as circular cross-section. So it determines the Young's modulus. Poisson ratio, it is defined as lateral strain divided by axial strain. And it may range from 0 to 0.5. They are very common in the range of 0.2 to 0.5, particularly for biological materials. These are some of the equations. Stress, tau is equal to F by A, strain, modulus, shear modulus, then simple compression, Young modulus, bulk compression, bulk modulus. And in a different condition, strain is different. You can see simple compression, strain, changing length, and if it is a volumetric, so delta V upon V, volumetric change. So this is the classification. Of non-Newtonian liquids, they are time dependent as well as time independent. And under time dependent means the shear is constant. Shear rate is constant. Then there are two types, rheopectic, thixotropic, and time independent. Here, the classification belongs to Herschel Barclay, Bingham plastic, shear thickening, also known as dilatant, shear thinning, also known as pseudoplastic, or which are governed by power law. This is the classification, and one by one we'll take that. This you can see flow curves between shear rate and shear stress. This is the flow curves between stress and strain, and this one, shear rate versus viscosity. So here you can see, ideally viscous on Newtonian flow behavior, viscosity is constant. Here viscosity is higher, the slope is higher, slope is less. So accordingly, you can see that change in viscosity. These are different curves, flow curves, viscosity curves, and when it is having a yield point. So you can see, first one is the ideally viscous, second one is shear thinning. You can see the pattern of the graph and shear thickening. The viscosity is increasing. And the viscosity curve, you can see for first one, viscosity is constant. For second one, viscosity is decreasing. For third one, which is dilatant or shear thickening, shear is increasing. So shear thickening, so viscosity is increasing. And these are the graphs with and without a yield point. So the fourth one, it is without a yield point, and this is here the yield stress. So this follows the pattern, but with the yield stress. Here also you can see the shear rate as well as shear stress curve, which I have shown earlier one. These are the time independent fluids, apparent viscosity. So why it is apparent? Why we are not taking simple viscosity? Why it is apparent? Because it is changing from point to point. So the bottom line shows the Newtonian fluids, then the shear thinning, shear thickening, then after attaining a yield stress, this is the Bingham and Herschel Barclay. But these are the time independent fluids. These are time dependent. Okay. Time at constant shear rate. Time at constant shear rate. Here, the shear rate is constant. And earlier one, time was constant. So yes, with the time at constant shear rate and here shear stress, you can see the behavior. This is the time independent. And if there are time dependent, then viscosity is increasing. For thixotropic, viscosity is decreasing. This we'll see in other slides also. These are different equations, so I'm not going into detail. These are the general one you can see in any of the reference book. These are the coefficient, consistency coefficient. Okay. Flow behavior index, denoted by N, and consistency index. Here you can see consistency index and flow behavior index. So if the values in that equation, if varies between 0 to infinity for the Herschel Barclay model, and the value of K will be greater than 0. But the stress, yield stress, it will be greater than 0. For Newtonian fluids, the consistency coefficient, it will be greater than 0. Value of slope, it will be 1. And since it originates it starts from the origin, then the yield stress is 0. And the case with the shear thinning, consistency coefficient will be greater than 0, but values varies between 0 to 1. And since there is no yield stress, so sigma naught is equal to zero. For the case of shear thickening, values varies between 1 to infinity. So likewise, the Bingham plastic, but it is having the yield stress. So the value of yield stress is greater than zero because it is having some value of the yield stress. So now the rheological characterization of time-dependent fluids, time-dependent. Viscosity, everybody knows, it is a measure of fluid's resistance to motion when some shear stress is applied. So they are Newtonian or they may be non-Newtonian, and their behavior, flow behavior, it may vary significantly during processing. So processing conditions are very important. And sometimes the ideal liquid is often referred to as a Newtonian liquid, and they may have different characteristics. They are incompressible, they are isotropic, they are structureless. And for this ideal liquid, stress is equal to viscosity into rate of strain, or viscosity is the ratio of stress versus rate of strain. Not simple strain, rate of strain. It differs from the ideal elastic solid. Why? Because the shear stress is proportional to the rate of strain rather than the strain. So if you consider the previous slide, it is the rate of strain rather than simple strain. So these are the units, Newton per meter square, and this is viscosity of water in different units, 1 millipascal second, 0.001 pascal second, 0.01 poise, also known as centipoise. Okay, this is in the SI system. Now the non-ideal liquids, the viscosity of that liquid depends upon the rate as well as time over which the shear force is applied. So shear rate and time. So now the shear rate dependent. What should be the shear rate dependent non-ideal behavior? The viscosity. It may increase or decrease as the shear rate is increased rather than staying constant as for Newtonian liquid. So here the shear rate dependent, here the shear rate is changing. And in these fluids, as I have said earlier, the viscosity is referred to as an apparent viscosity because it is changing from point to point. And two most common types of these particular liquids, they are known as pseudoplastic, showing shear thinning behavior, and dilatant fluids, showing the shear thickening behavior. So they are time independent. Time independent, but shear rate dependent. This is the shear thinning behavior. This is shear rate or rate of strain. This is shear stress. So here you can see how the viscosity changes. Viscosity is decreasing. Here, eta 1 viscosity at shear rate 1, it is greater than viscosity at different shear rate, strain rate, okay, or shear rate. So the shear rate is changing, the viscosity is changing, right? So what is the basic behind this? These are the polymer molecules. They may be a chain-like macromolecule. This is a C actually. So they are coiled, they are entangled, but under shear, they deform in the direction of shear. And they show the disentanglements. Here you can see they are coiled, but here uncoiled. And the deformation is in the shear direction. That is very important. Consequences, shear thinning flow behavior, which decreases the viscosity. These are the same thing. Increasing shear rate here, initially coiled, but disentanglement. Okay. Now shear thickening. It is a tendency of the materials to increase in viscosity when driven to flow at high shear rates. So these are the molecules at equilibrium. And in the case of shear thinning, it is like this. But in the case of shear thickening, they aggregate. And because of that, viscosity increases. Now the time dependent. Here the shear rate is constant. Here shear rate is a constant, but the time is changing. So rheological properties of these materials, they depend upon duration of the applied shear. Shear rate is constant, but how long they are being applied, that depends the behavior of that material. So such as suspension, emulsion, and some foams, they are time-dependent fluids. And thixotropic and rheopectic behavior are being shown by those particular materials. So what is thixotropic? It is the one in which the apparent viscosity decreases with time at constant shear rate. And the reduction in its structural strength during that constant shear rate or the shear load phase, which is rapid, but complete structural regeneration occurs during the subsequent rest phase. It means it regenerates itself. Whereas the rheopectic, when the apparent viscosity increases with time, obviously at the constant shear rate, so what happens? Increase in the structural strength during the load phase, which is also rapid, more or less, but complete decomposition of the increased structural strength during the subsequent period of rest. It means there is no regeneration. Whereas in the case of thixotropic material, it is the complete regeneration structurally. So thixotropic, there is a difference between thixotropic fluid and a shear thinning fluid. Thixotropic, decrease in viscosity at constant shear rate. With time, shear thinning, decrease viscosity, but increasing shear rate. Here at constant shear rate, here at increasing shear rate, behavior is same, shear thinning, decrease in viscosity, but the nomenclature is different. Rheopectic, they are also known as anti-thixotropic. Whereas the constant shear stress for a time is applied and which causes an increase in viscosity or even solidification. So constant shear, it can be applied by shaking or mixing. And fluids which exhibit this type of property, they are also known as rheopectic. And then rheodestructive fluids. In this type of fluid, the time-dependent rheological properties are irreversible, as in the case of rheopectic. But they are known as rheodestructive. Once the shear force is removed, the system, it will not regain its initial rheological properties. So when they show the permanent changes, they are known as rheodestructive property. And it occurs when aggregated particles, they are permanently disrupted and they do not reform with time. Now the plastics, what is the ideal plastic behavior? They can have elastic properties below a certain applied stress, that is known as yield stress, and they are also known as Bingham plastic. These are the equation for stress, it should be greater than zero. Okay. Above the yield stress, the fluid flow, they will exhibit non-Newtonian behavior similar to the pseudoplastic, dilatant, thixotropic or rheopectic behavior. Okay. And the plastic materials, they exhibit plastic behavior as I have shown in the previous slide, below the yield stress, but the viscous behavior above the yield stress. But the viscoelastic materials, they exhibit both viscous as well as elastic behavior simultaneously. That is why they are known as viscoelastic materials. And when force is applied to a viscoelastic material, it does not instantaneously take up its new dimension as in the case of elastic material. It will take some time because of the viscous forces. Okay. So because of these viscous forces, it will not instantaneously take up its new dimensions. But when the force is removed, the material does not return instantaneously. Again, as compared to elastic material, the material does not return instantaneously back to its non-deformed state, but even remain permanently deformed. So why the permanently deformed? Because it is having a viscous component in addition to the elastic component. So because of that viscous component, it will not take up its new dimension and it will remain permanently, it may remain permanently deformed when the force is removed. Because if you consider the elastic material, when we apply the force, it takes up instantaneously its new dimension, and when you remove the force, in the case of elastic material, it will regain its normal position. So there are some transient as well as dynamic measurements. Transient experiments. Here in this case, a constant force is applied to the material and the resulting strain is measured as a function of time and vice versa. So when constant force is applied and the resulting strain is measured, that comes the creep test. Apply a constant stress and the changes in strain with time that are being measured in terms of compliance, which is a ratio of strain versus stress, and we study creep recovery. I'll show you in the next slide, complete graph. And at constant strain, means suppose you are compressing a dough, piece of dough in the cylindrical form, and we have given or we want to compress it for a particular strain, say 40%. So suppose the height of the dough piece or the dough cylinder in a flat disc form, the height is 10 mm. And if you want to compress it to 40%, it means we are compressing to it just to 6 mm. So we are giving the 40% strain. We want to keep this strain as 40%. And how much force is required that we measure to keep that strain constant. And you will see that because of this viscoelastic behavior, after applying the force to maintain the constant strain, after a certain time, the force, it will start decaying. Because it is viscoelastic material and because of the elastic component, it will try to expand the dough piece. And when it will try to expand the dough piece, the force will decay to maintain that strain as 40%. Here you can see strain. Strain is constant. Strain is constant. So stress is decreasing. At time zero, we have given the stress to maintain the strain at this level. And afterwards, the strain is constant. You see the horizontal line. And at constant strain, how different materials behave, you can see in the case of viscoelastic liquid, the force decays and it will come to its original position. Ideal elastic material, it will regain its original form, as in the case of ideal viscous material. But if this is the viscoelastic solid, then force is decaying, but it will not regain its original position. Okay. So this is the experiment for stress relaxation. Here we are keeping the strain constant. Now the creep recovery properties. Earlier we have seen the stress relaxation at constant strain. Here we are seeing the properties, how it changes under a constant stress. Here you can see stress is constant. Sorry. Initial, we have given some stress. Then strain, strain is changing in case of strain is constant in case of ideal elastic material. No flow. And the complete recovery in case of elastic material. In the case of ideal viscous material, there will be a steady flow, but no recovery. In the case of viscoelastic material, recovery will be there, but there will be some permanent deformation. Flow will be there. In the ideal elastic, there will be no flow. In ideal viscous, there will be flow. In ideal viscous, no recovery. Ideal elastic, complete recovery, but in viscoelastic, partial recovery. So you can see the difference, no flow, flow, steady flow. No recovery, partial recovery, complete recovery. So it changes from no recovery to complete recovery and no flow to steady flow. And there will be a permanent deformation. Time versus strain, stress. Here you can see instantaneous elastic strain, delayed elastic strain. This instantaneous, this is delayed. Then the strain produced by viscous flow because it is a viscoelastic material. Then instantaneous elastic strain. When we remove the force, when we remove the stress, then delayed elastic strain. So strain is changing, but because of that viscous nature, it is delayed. This is instantaneous because of the elastic nature. This is delayed because of the viscous nature. And then this is strain due to viscous flow. Recovery is there, but it is not complete. So based on this experiment, we can determine the safe stress below which it would be safe to operate when the time requirement of the end use application is given. So we can determine that particular safe stress so that how much recovery we want, whether we want full recovery or partial recovery or no recovery, that would depend upon the stress value. So we can determine the safe stress under this creep recovery test. So these are the practical applications of creep recovery. They provide information about the internal structure of the system. And these structure alterations, they are caused by changes in its composition. And these informations are useful for determining process or process strength, like temperature. It may cause permanent deformation in the material. As you know, that temperature is an important parameter in the case of food processing. And for determining means which ingredients they will induce resistance to deformation of the product, which would affect the quality of the end product or the byproduct. So that we can determine based on this creep recovery test. And in particular product development, it may utilize starch at different concentrations as gelling agents. I'll show you one of the experiment in further slides. So these are the modeling of creep curves, how we can define the different models based on this creep recovery test. I will show you these models, but you must be knowing earlier also. This is a dashboard. The spring, the elastic component, is the viscous component. This Kelvin void part and this Maxwell part. When they have this elastic and viscous component in series, and when they are in parallel, then Kelvin void. These are the compliance we are measuring against time. So this is the instantaneous response because of this elastic component, and then delayed, retarded elastic behavior because of the viscous component. They're in the parallel fashion. So because of this viscous component, there is a delayed long time viscous flow because of this viscous component. And afterwards, when the force is removed, the stress is removed, then the instantaneous recovery, and this is the delayed recovery. So Maxwell model, the applied equation is this, and in the four parameter Berger model, this is the Berger model, and this type of equation is being applied. So why we want to fit models to viscoelastic data? Obviously, to quantify that data, which gives the mathematical representation for use with other food processing applications. And there are some food frying models which require these viscoelastic properties. In the case of designing of pipelines, as I have initially said, and they are used in the designing purpose for this mixing vessels, which are using viscoelastic fluid force, and so many other applications. This is a strain recovery. I have said that at different starch concentration, recovery will be different. So here you can see at 3%, when we prepared the gel, it did not possess the viscoelastic behavior. So the percent recovery is zero. But when we increase the concentration of starch to make the gel, the percent recovery, it is followed by an increasing trend with increasing concentration. We are increasing the concentration of starch in the gel, and the percent recovery is increasing. It means it is showing an elastic behavior when we increase the concentration of starch. So it is in consistence with the more elastic property, which is exhibited by the starch gels at higher concentration. So the extent of strain recovery of this starch gel, it will depend upon the strain, which is attained at the end of recovery period, which is calculated as this compliance at 250 second, minus at 500 seconds, and initially by 2 into 100. So here, my point would be very clear. Okay, so when we increase the starch concentration in the gel, the percent recovery is increasing because it is showing toward the elastic nature of the gel. Now, the dynamic experiments. You can see that oscillation, okay? So sinusoidal stress, it is applied to a material, then the results are the sinusoidal strain, or vice versa. When the sinusoidal strains are being taken, then it will be applied by the sinusoidal stress. There will be a change in sinusoidal stress. Okay, as we can see that constant strain for stress relaxation, but for constant stress, there is a creep recovery test. Okay, those are the transient one, but now it is a dynamic experiment. So the applied stress, it is characterized by its maximum amplitude, tau naught, and its angular frequency because it is rotating or it's revolving, known as omega. And the resulting strain, it will have the same frequency as the applied stress, but the phase is different. I'll show you in the next slides. The phase is different because of the relaxation mechanism which are associated with the particular material. And the amplitude of these applied stress, which are being used in this type of test, they are usually so small that the material is in the linear viscoelastic region, LVR, which we apply in the study of sample under modular rheometer. Here in this case, the stress is proportional to the strain for small amplitudes. Okay. So the dynamic shear rheological properties of those materials, it can be defined, it can be described by complex shear modulus, which is a sum of G prime, that is storage modulus, plus delta, that is the phase change, and loss modulus. So tan delta, it is a ratio of loss modulus versus storage modulus. And the stress, it can be given by this equation. The storage modulus, it is the measure of the energy stored in the material per cycle. And where the energy is stored? In the spring. And that is why the elastic materials are being represented as spring. Loss modulus, it is a measure of the energy dissipated as heat per cycle. Loss modulus, because the energy is lost. And that is why the liquids are, the viscous material are being represented as a dashpot, where the liquid is filled, but it is under pressure. It is being removed through a hole in the dashpot. For a perfectly elastic material, the stress and strain, they are completely in phase. But for a perfectly viscous material, all the energy is lost as heat. And then they are of the 90 degree out of phase, stress and strain. I'll show you the graph. The phase angle that the stress lags behind the strain, it is given as delta. And this delta is different for different types of material. 0 degree for a perfectly elastic solid, 90 degree for a perfectly viscous fluid, as they are 90 degree out of phase. For perfectly viscous material, all the energy lost, but for elastic material, energy is regained, then they are in the similar phase. And for viscoelastic material, this angle, it varies between 0 and 90 degree, elastic and viscous. The more elastic material, the smaller the phase angle, lower the amount of energy dissipated per cycle. This is a viscoelastic measurement. This is the rotation one, okay? Storage modulus given by this, loss modulus given by this equation, loss tangent. And when delta is zero, these are the Hookean elastic solid. When delta is between 0 to 90 degree, viscoelastic material, and delta is 90 degree out of phase, then known as viscous liquid. This is the oscillator, top bar, sample, cup, it is oscillating like this. And because of that, phase angle, you can see phase angle that will be shown in the next slide completely. This you can see. Dynamic mechanical testing response for classical extremes. You can see here. Hookean solid, in case of Hookean solid, they are in the same phase. The stress is also varying, changing behavior like this. The strain is also behaving like this. Purely elastic response. Purely viscous. You can see here, the angle is 90 degrees. These are out of phase. Here you can see. For this phase angle, it varies. You can see here, this peak is coming here. Okay, this peak is coming here, trough, not peak. So the phase angle changes. The phase angle between strain and stress, it is changing. It is changing between 0 to 90 degree for this viscoelastic material. Again, you can see this one is out of phase, it is in phase, but in case of viscoelastic material, they are in between 0 to 90 degree. This dynamic mechanical analysis of visco, this is the viscoelastic parameters. Stress, which is a dynamic experiment in the, that referred as complex stress. Phase angle is the same thing as I have shown you in the previous slide. Strain and stress. So it is a sum of that. sigma prime plus that angle and sigma double prime. These are different terms. The complex modulus, measure of materials, overall resistance to deformation can be given by this equation. Then elastic modulus, it can be given by this equation, cos delta, viscous modulus, sine delta, complex stress, okay. Then tan delta, it is given by G double prime by G prime. I have shown you earlier one also. So how I have calculated with the help of this triangle, you can very well understand. So the viscosity measured in oscillatory experiment, it is a complex viscosity. And in the same way, the modulus can be expressed as a complex modulus. And this viscosity, it will have elastic component and which is a term similar to the steady state viscosity. And it is defined as G complex, complex modulus divided by omega. Yes, if time permits, can I describe this, Dr. Amandeep?
Yes, sir. Please go on, please.
Okay. Because I have crossed the time limit, that's why I have asked this. Okay, now that's very important, actually. What are the fundamental and empirical rheological methods? Fundamental, I will first talk about the empirical rheological methods. Why these are known as empirical? Because they do not involve the direct, you can say, basic units of force and deformation. Whereas the fundamental methods, they account for the magnitude and direction of forces and deformation. And they are based on the known concept as equations of physics. But the empirical one, they are not based on the known concept as well as the equation of physics. They are empirically developed. They are used when sample composition and geometry is too complex, which is true for most of the four materials. Okay. So when they are too complex to account for forces and deformations, and they are of value if they can be correlated with a particular property of interest. Whereas the fundamental, as I have shown you earlier one, that slide, fundamental test, they determine the true physical properties, force and deformation. So Newton and time, that seconds, or deformation in the units of centimeter or mm. But this empirical method, they do not show the behavior or the properties in terms of these true physical properties. So they have been developed by some scientists based on different experiments. They have fixed certain value. For example, this Farino graph. This is a very old one, and this is the new one. It's very old. I have used this also in my PhD time. But now it is obsolete. Here you can see we used to read the chart on this radial chart. Okay, this is the pen and this is the mixer. Okay, forget about this. So these are the Farino. This is equipment name is Farino graph, and that graph is known as Farinogram. Okay, so now it is attached to the computer. It can give so many calculations. I will show you. This is the Farino graph. This width of the curve, here you are seeing width of the, this is the 500 BU line. There are so many lines, 0, 100, 200, 300, 400, and 500, the horizontal line. So this graph is remain stable at 500. This is BU on the y-axis, that is the BU, Brabender units, okay? And on the x-axis, is time or a distance or the displacement. Okay. So why this particular 500 VU line is fixed? So it is based on the experiments done by the scientist at Drebender, and he has done so many experiments, and he has seen that when on this farinogram the line touches at 500, at that particular consistency, the bread dough is optimum. Means we can prepare the dough, we can prepare the bread with that optimum consistency of dough, which gives the good quality bread. Low quality will be also good. So based on those experiments, he has standardized 500 VU line for preparation of good quality bread. Likewise, you can change this standardized line or the unit of the Drebender based on your experiment, based on your product. Suppose in our department at CFTR Mysore, we have standardized different consistency for different traditional products, so for puri dough, for tandoori roti dough, for naan dough, for paratha dough. We have standardized different Drebender units based on our experiments. Okay. So what is the significance of this line? The line, the curve which shows the stability at 500 BU, it is a requirement for a very good dough to prepare good quality bread. Suppose you have done experiment, you can see here weak gluten flour. Gluten everybody must be knowing. So if we prepare the dough with weak gluten, it means it will touch, it may touch the 500 VU line, but it will not hold that. It will fall below the 500 VU line. It means it is not having that particular strength because of the weak gluten. So that the bread prepared with this dough, it will not be a good quality bread. It will not have that loaf volume. Whereas if you have a strong gluten, then after touching the 500 BU line, it will be stable for a longer time. So this shows the strength of the flour with respect to this gluten content. So this is the arrival time, this is the peak time. Okay. Arrival time when it touches the 500 BU line, and this shows the stability, how long it remains on the 500 BU line. So at the point when it leaves the 500 BU line, that is shown as departure time, and the difference between the center of the curve at this and at peak, that will be the mixing tolerance index. It means how long it can tolerate the mixing. Whereas you can see here, it is having very low, means value is more, mixing tolerance index, but it cannot tolerate the mixing stress because the mixer is giving so much force to the dough, but it cannot tolerate. So it is a very weak dough, okay? Because it departs very early. Whereas in this type of curve, departure time is very high, okay? So this is the difference between weak gluten flour as well as strong gluten flour. And this 500 BU line is empirical, that is why it is known as empirical method. So this is the observation of farinogram coming out of the farinograph. Video I may not be able to show because it is not there. So this is the extensograph, time is also short. So here we study the extensibility as well as the resistance to extension. And these properties are very important for preparation of bread as well as this biscuit. Because in a biscuit, we need high extensibility. But in bread dough, we need higher resistance. In biscuit dough, we need less resistance but high extensibility. In bread dough, we need higher resistance but less extensibility. So with the help of this equipment, we may be able to get the different property. This is the extensogram unit, again developed by Brabender. And AICC method is there, means different experiments are there. And they are being approved by AICC, American Association of Cereal Chemists. This is a typical extensogram, and it will vary. Their extensibility as well as resistance, they may vary depending upon the material, depending upon the strength of the flour, depending upon the water absorption of the flour, depending upon the bran content, if we are taking the whole wheat flour. But there are so many other ingredients. This is the Milo graph. This is the rapid, this is the Milo graph. Now we are using the rapid visco analyzer. Actually, this myelogram is also an empirical one, but now we are using rapid visco analyzer. It gives the value in centipoise. So now we can say it is a fundamental test, because and we can convert this rapid visco unit RVU into the centipoise. There is a conversion formula. Here we heat the starch paste, and it transforms into starch slurry. And based on the starch property, based on the enzymatic reaction, the slurry is also thin or thick. And based on that, we determine the pasting properties of starch. How the starch behaves in the presence of different ingredients, and there are so many other conditions. How we grind the starch, and from where we are taking the starch, and whether we are doing modification with the help of some chemicals or the heat moisture treatment, or by IR method, or that obviously heat moisture treatment or the alkali treatment. So the starch pasting property, it will change. And when we add some other ingredient, so how it will behave, and what are the conditions of preparing the starch, what are the conditions of preparing the gel or paste. So there's so many parameters which we can study in this rapid visco analyzer. And we can change the heating rate also, means how fast should be the process of heating. It can vary from 1.5 degree centigrade per minute to say 12 degree centigrade per minute. And if you change the heating rate as well as cooling rate, so the pattern of graph will be different. And it depends upon the conditions in which you are performing your experiment in real time. This is a Chopin LVO graph. Usually we take these data as we have the data in the finograph, extensograph. It is a combination one. So this is the consistograph, this is the LVO graph. So here we measure the water absorption of flour. And here we measure the properties similar to the extensograph, if you remember in my previous slides. So this is a typical LVO graph curve. So this also gives the value in a true physical quantity. Okay. This is a following number one. It determines the alpha amylase enzyme presence in the flour. If the enzyme is in a very less quantity, okay, then what will happen? It will not form a slurry. The paste will be very thick, because the enzymatic action will not be there on the starch to liquefy that starch. And if the enzyme activity is very high, alpha amylase content is very high, suppose in case of sprouted wheats, if I take the example of that, so in that case, because of the enzymatic activity, liquefaction will be very high. And in that case, the starch slurry will be very thin, and the stir, it will fall. It will fall very fast. So the time taken in second, it will be very short. And because of that, we can determine whether it is it will be suitable for preparing bread, for example, or not. If time is very short, it means enzymatic activity is very high, then we have to change the flour, or we have to mix the flour having low enzymatic activity. But if the alpha amylase activity is very less, it means time taken is very high, then in that case we have to add malt to make the flour suitable for making good quality bread. So this I have shown you earlier one also. This is the Maxwell model, this is the Kelvin-Watt model, and this is four component Brugger model. So this is the end of my slide. So any questions?
Sir, I have a question. Dr. Narendra, can I ask the question?
Yes, please. Yes, please. Yeah, please.
Okay. Hello, sir. I'm Dr. Gopika Talwar.
Yes.
Sir, I just wanted to ask. We have two type of tests, like fundamental test and empirical also, and and imitative also. Yes. Is there any instrument that takes care of all the things, like fundamental also and empirical also, imitative also? Any instrument?
No, ma'am. Right now, I don't have that much knowledge. Maybe somebody is developing, or.
I think that would be ideal. Ideal instrument would be that would take care of the fundamental test also and empirical also.
Yeah, that is
it. That would be of help to engineers and food technologists, both.
Yes.
So even in my knowledge, I don't know if there is an instrument. I thought might be there is some research.
Okay, I'll keep in mind. I'll also look for that equipment. I'll talk to my international colleagues. So they may be having some knowledge, or they may be in the stage of development.
Yeah, even I'm looking for it. Yeah.
That would be a good choice. Thank you.
Yeah.
Students, any question? Any query you want to have? Any basic question? Any research-related question by the master students? So I welcome you for the questions.
Webinar.
Hello.
Hello, any questions here?
Sir, I hope most of the students got a good idea about the rheology, sir, because you cover each and everything. An entire course is full of rheology and its application in the various fields, and especially you emphasize on the designing of the equipments and the application of rheology in designing the equipments, especially the mixing equipments. And I hope students are clear about what are the various applications and what are the various perspectives of studying the rheology. So thank you very much, sir. I will hand over next session. Vote of thanks to Dr. Gopika. Thank you, sir.
Okay. Thank you, Nan. Thank you, Dr. Narendra. Dr. Gopika is muted, I think.
Sir, can everybody hear me now?
Yeah, please.
Yes, madam.
Yeah. I would like to extend my thanks to IDP Cell Garvasu for providing this opportunity and facilities to conduct this seminar. Huge thanks to our Vice Chancellor, Dr. Inderjeet Singh, for their immense motivation for the series of webinars that are being conducted these days. We can hear two different speakers all over the globe now. My sincere thanks to Dr. S.P.S. Ghumman, who is PI of the IDP project, as well as his Dean of College of Veterinary Sciences. Sincere thanks to our Dean, Dr. Ramneek Verma, for without his immense support and motivation, it would not have been possible. And a huge thanks to our speaker of today, Dr. D.C. Saxena, for a very elaborate lecture on rheology, which is a very upcoming field. Even I when I teach them, I find it very challenging. It was a very good lecture for me also. I could add one or two points to my lecture from what has been told to me by DC Saxena sir today.
Always
and welcome. Thank you so much, sir. It was a very elaborate lecture. I would take two or three slides from this and add to my PPT also. Lastly, my sincere thanks to all the students who have shown active participation. We have requested fourth year because they go through the course of food engineering and also are MTech students. I just taught them yesterday about the fundamental test and empirical test. And I hope this was more like a revision for them and they will look forward to it. Thank you, everyone. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr.
Thank you, Dr. Good evening.
Thank you, Dr. Amandeep.